ago, there lived an extraordinary individual. We feel the impact of his innovations every time we use a pair of scissors, test our courage to go skydiving, and even when we cross the span of an elegantly designed bridge. Today, there's even a robotic surgeon named after him, perhaps in honor of his expertise in both human physiology and his aptitude for engineering. We recall his legacy when we glimpse a war chariot in a movie, try to read something written backwards, and especially when we contemplate some of the greatest paintings of all time. Leonardo da Vinci was his name, and he is what the world considers the most celebrated Renaissance man there is. Now, contrary to popular belief, Da Vinci wasn't trained exclusively to become a professional painter, or even a scientist for that matter. In fact, he received a basic education in reading and writing, and exposure to skills ranging from metalworking and carpentry to drawing and painting. Yet it's precisely this unique background that enabled him to build a bridge between the arts and the sciences. This bridge is summarized most aptly, I believe, with an illustration. An illustration of the Vitruvian Man. Sketched onto leathery parchment, this drawing represents the true essence of the Renaissance. A fusion of anatomical precision, mathematical symmetry, and artistic rendition. Science and art, analysis and intuition. A symbol for thinking across the boundaries of disciplines, using what you learn in one place and applying it to the other. Something that I have come to call interdisciplinary innovation. Now, I stumbled upon this concept of interdisciplinary innovation for the first time during my freshman year of high school. I was reading a science article about thermoelectrics. And as someone who'd grown up visiting the Grand Coulee Dam, listening to lectures about the energy grid, and ogling at solar panels, I was absolutely mind blown that I'd never seen, or at the very least even heard, of this technology before in my everyday life. For those of you that don't know, thermoelectrics are basically a way to generate electricity from heat with no moving parts. So imagine placing one of these devices inside of your flashlight and being able to power it with nothing but the heat coming from your hand. We should be seeing these everywhere, right? But we don't. And so that prompted me to delve a little bit deeper. And I found that it's oftentimes because thermoelectric materials are simply too expensive, they're composed of toxic elements, or they're not mechanically robust enough to be applied outside of the laboratory. And after contacting thermoelectrics experts, ranging from foreign universities to energy startups, I realized that there was this disconnect between the materials research being done to synthesize the most efficient material possible and the engineers attempting to apply it commercially. And so drawing inspiration from this divide and collaborating with professionals who expressed some of the same frustrations over this disconnect, I've been fortunate enough to be able to conduct my own research into developing a more cost-effective thermoelectric module. The new materials combination that I worked on may allow us to one day charge a phone using the exhaust heat coming from your car's tailpipe, or even recover energy from the smokestack of a nearby coal power plant. But the most important thing that I discovered during this entire process was that this project would not have been possible if I hadn't taken into account both the material science behind high-performing compounds and the engineering principles that define their compatibility. And as a 15-year-old who had been led to believe that specialization equates success, this was a surprise to me. But it's exactly what drew me further into the world of scientific research. In my sophomore year, I applied this Renaissance-esque principle a little bit further. While talking to a bioengineering student about sepsis, which is a severe condition caused by bacterial infections, I was surprised to learn that a toxin that's excreted by half of all bacterial species is detected primarily by using a chemical that's derived from the blood of a horseshoe crab. The first thing I thought was, poor horseshoe crabs. But then something else came to mind. Something completely different that I'd been reading about recently. Polymers. For several decades now, scientists have been pursuing a new method of molecular recognition, an imprinted polymer. You might think of these structures as plastic antibodies that form around a template and can bind to their target like a lock and key. And so I wondered, what if it's possible to use such a polymer to bind to the toxin and detect it and put an end to its activity? And so I began my journey, traversing the lines between chemistry and biology, diagnosis and therapy, to design, create, and test a solution that might one day allow us to mitigate the effects of sepsis. Now, over these past 2 years, the application of this principle within my research has led me to places ranging from the Intel International Science and Engineering Fair all the way to the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory. But I want to say that I could not have done this without inspiration from the work of scientists, both past and present. You see, the concept of interdisciplinary innovation is certainly not a new one. It's a practice that we find at every research institution around the world, whether it's a computer scientist working to design new algorithms to predict how proteins fold, to a mechanical engineer using cellulose to create stronger, transparent materials. And it's these very connections across disciplines that have introduced us to the wealth of novel solutions that lie at the intersections of our existing knowledge. But I ask, why confine the motivation to think across disciplines between the walls of a laboratory? We all have a spark of the Renaissance polymath within us. After all, I'm sure you remember at some point in your own childhood receiving the devastating news that you can't be a pop star, a cowboy, and a tech entrepreneur all at the same time. And while I can't say that channeling the Renaissance will allow you to achieve those five-year-old dreams, it will enhance your ability to approach problems from a more unique and inclusive perspective. It starts with mustering the courage to pursue seemingly unrelated interests. Society often tells us that we must focus on one discipline in life, but it's the ability to defy this social norm that sets apart the innovators. Take, for example, Noam Chomsky, a modern-day polymath. As a student, he explored his interests in both linguistics and logic. Yet it never deterred him that he was pursuing two fields that most people view as having very little in common, simply because they were both his passion. Today, he's one of the most widely cited figures in the arts and the humanities, and has published several pioneering papers on mathematical linguistics, which have contributed to everything from social media to psychology. But there's no point in pursuing these passions if you don't delve deep and sustain them over time. The point is not to become a jack of all trades, master of none, but rather to develop your expertise in an area that's not confined to just one subject. This principle is exemplified by Manjul Bhargava, a mathematician with a unique background. From a young age, he was exposed to Sanskrit scriptures and learned how to play the tabla from renowned masters. But he also held a pointed passion for mathematics, completing all high school math and computer science at the age of 14. To this day, he continues to play the tabla while teaching as a professor at the Princeton University. And his cross-pollination between music and math have led him to numerous advances in number theory. Most importantly, the innovation only takes place if you apply what you learn in one discipline to the other. The best way to do this is by learning the skills, not the discipline. In this way, you don't restrict yourself to just one school of thought, and are instead equipped with the tools that can be applied in countless ways. Perhaps the most well-known instance of this is Steve Jobs. As the story goes, Jobs dropped out of Reed College at the age of 19 and decided to take calligraphy classes out of pure curiosity. What he learned from this 2,600-year-old artistic practice revolutionized the way he designed the Mac interface with multiple aesthetic and proportionally spaced typefaces. Today, it's almost scary to think how our screens might look without various fonts. So to summarize, a courage to pursue your passions, perseverance to delve deep within them, and an initiative for interconnected application. These are the qualities that define these three components of the modern day Renaissance, as well as countless others, some of whom may even be sitting among us today. But you might still be thinking, why is it important for me or the people around me to channel an ideology of the past? To answer this question, it's necessary to talk about our profound cultural legacy. About 4 or 5 centuries ago, society deemed it acceptable, even venerable, to pursue multiple disciplines, to be a Renaissance woman or man, experience a broad education, and display competence in a variety of fields was the ideal for citizens at the time. Yet as time went on and we approached the 21st century, specialization became more important than anything. And while people acquired deep understandings of their field of study, some went on to become experts with narrow mindsets and limited perspectives of the disciplines of others. But we often find that history repeats itself. And in our case, this might be necessary. We are currently preparing students for jobs that don't yet exist, using technologies that haven't been invented, to solve problems we don't even know are problems yet. This is a quote from Carl Fish and Scott McLeod, two high school technology teachers. This task, as daunting as it sounds, seems possible when we encourage students to cross-pollinate between the different subjects they learn from and build bridges between them. Imagine a classroom where students are allowed to soak up the history of the Leaning Tower of Pisa, while also learning about the physics of why it hasn't already fallen over. Or the winter art project being compounded with an explanation, the winter art project of making snowflakes being compounded with an explanation of fractals and the mathematical patterns that we find in nature. But it's not enough to simply encourage students to pursue interdisciplinary interests. In fact, this only becomes possible when we allow the people that these students learn from and look up to infuse the rich experiences that span these bridges into the task at hand. This means living in a world where an architect with a lifelong passion for gardening being able to put her love for nature to work by designing an eco-friendly building inspired by plants. Or even an avid bookworm who also happens to work as an IT specialist being able to use her experience with rhetoric to craft more user-friendly error messages. You see, we are moving towards an intellectually advanced future where solutions are no longer confined to just one discipline. And as we do so, it's important to keep in mind that the principles of Da Vinci and the Renaissance still stay with us, no matter how dramatically they may have changed in appearance over the past couple hundred years. This robotic Vitruvian man is a product of the technological advances we've made since then. Yet it still retains elements of human structure and anatomy. It represents the evolution of innovation. But what excites me the most about this evolution is the fact that so many of these innovations are spun from the convergence of knowledge that we already hold. Da Vinci once said, "I have been impressed with the urgency of doing. Knowing is not enough. We must apply. Being willing is not enough. We must do." Thank you.